and our tube fares are higher than any comparable city in the world. We have problems around air pollution, and we have problems with our bus service. The average bus holds only 15 people and can seat up to 83. So many more things that we can sort out, and the mayor sits at the apex of London government, has an opportunity to shape the city. Now, I have a track record of delivery, but also as a winner. I won in Hammersmith and Fulham and pulled down the red flag and won that council for the first time since 1968 and won again. I know how to beat Labour, but I also know how to deliver, cutting council tax 5 times in 6 years, also whilst improving public services. But importantly, I have a plan for London. I want to cut tube fares and rail fares by 3%, and that saves on average £900 over 3 years. I want to do something about the fact that we face a real stress on our public services, like finding 800 million. I will protect neighbourhood policing and support neighbourhood policing with 5,000 bodies in neighbourhoods by ring-fencing our council tax and business rate growth. I will do something about air pollution. So I have a track record of delivery. Now, I want your confidence to be able to deliver for London, because I have delivered, I can deliver, and I will deliver. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Stephen. We'll come back to the specifics of some of what you've spoken about in just a moment, but this is all about winning an election. We now know who the Labour candidate will be in that election. Why are you the best Conservative candidate to beat him?
I've had a background in local government of understanding what Labour's like, machine politicians like Sadiq Khan. I faced 3 opponents at one stage. Labour council leader, the deputy leader, who's now the leader, and the MP, Andrew Slaughter, and then Neil Coleman before him. All of them focus on personality and try and stop you focusing on what you will do to better the lives of the people you seek to serve. So the important thing in politics is to recognise why you want to be in government, why you want to be in power, and form a programme. And that's why I thought very carefully about a plan for London, a plan that will do something about the cost of public transport, helping Londoners onto the home ownership ladder, doing something about the fact that so many police officers and city workers cannot afford to live. It's actually having a practical plan that can be delivered in one mayoral term.
So you talked about lots of things that you think concern Londoners. What do you think is the single thing that worries Londoners the most, and how will you be able to stop them worrying about it?
The single most important thing is that we cannot become a capital city that is polarised between the very richest and the very poorest. At the moment, those on low and middle incomes are simply choosing to move out of our city. It's not good. And we need those high-skilled jobs filled by people that can afford to live in our capital city. So it must be housing supply. The cost of housing is the single biggest issue. The single biggest solution to that is obviously to deal with the fact that we have so much surplus public land. London is half the density of Paris and New York. There's plenty of opportunity to release public land and build on it. And I've had experience of that in both my jobs, of how you can turn brownfield sites, land that is poorly used, into land that can house literally thousands of Londoners.
How can you guarantee that you will be able to deliver that housing that you talk about? Is it absolutely all in your power if you become mayor? Because each and every one of you as candidates makes these big promises about affordable housing.
That's a really good question, because people are sick and tired of politicians who promise a lot and fail to deliver. Now, I've worked out that Transport for London owns more land than the London Borough of Camden, an inner city than the London Borough. 5,700 acres. 1,000 acres is developable in one mayoral term. That would not only raise £20 billion, you could build at least 50,000 homes for Londoners to own, controlling just one agency of the mayoralty. That doesn't take into account GLA land. It doesn't take into account other public sector land, Network Rail or the NHS. And you should look at my record. All the police buildings that we sold have booked the police £1 billion they can reinvest in frontline policing, and meant that we've been able to keep police officers at around 32,000. When Hammersmith Fulham, we halved the council debt by selling off office space, turning that into homes. So I've had experience of turning that rhetoric into reality.
You talk there about the police. Only this morning, the head of MI5 said the country is facing probably the biggest terror threat for 30 years. We all know that London is probably the most attractive target for terrorists when we're talking about the United Kingdom. How can you ensure that Londoners are safe when the Met is facing drastic budget cuts?
That's a really critical question for London. The police are working their socks off. They are arresting a terrorist literally about the rate of one a day. It's getting worse. So we are really facing a level of threat that we haven't seen in recent times. We've got to recognise that dealing with that falls into three parts. We need communities to be able to step forward, to feel confident, to say, when you see something, say something, do something. So communities need to help. But equally, the police work very closely with the security services. So the key is to lobby for that bit of the mayor that counter-terrorist policing gets the money it needs to keep us safe. And effectively, it gets its fair share of the budget. Because there's one part of the police budget which is protected. But when you get an increase, as we've seen, we need to make sure that policing isn't shortchanged, because they play a critical role in keeping us safe.